Fatty liver is exactly what the name indicates. The liver accumulates too much fat, too much lipid. And if it's allowed to continue, fatty liver can lead to cirrhosis. There are several causes of fatty liver. A chronic intake of alcohol is a common one. And then there is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, or NAFLD, which is often seen together with overweight, obesity, and diabetes. A brand new clinical trial looked at dietary approaches to address and improve NAFLD, non-alcoholic fatty liver. They took 88 people with NAFLD, and they had them all restrict calories. Men were told to eat between 15 and 1800 calories a day, and women between 12 and 1500. Then they split the participants randomly into two groups, and one of those groups was also told to fast in the evening, what's called time-restricted eating. So they were asked to eat all of their food between the hours of 8 a.m. and 4 p.m. and to fast after that all the way to the next day at 8 a.m. again. So the trial is comparing one group that's restricting calories to another group that's also restricting calories plus eating all of those calories, all of their food, earlier in the day. Obviously, there's a lot of other ways you could design a trial like this and many other questions you could ask. For example, you could take people eating their normal diet and tell only half of them to fast. So you'd be comparing fasting to no intervention. The way they chose to do it, the question they're asking is, does fasting, does time-restricted eating, eating all your calories in the morning, provide an additional benefit on top of restricting calories? So they followed the participants for 1 year total, during the course of which they kept in touch. They had a team of registered dietitians touching base with the participants, making sure that they didn't have any issues, giving them advice, making sure they were compliant, etc. And compliance was pretty good in average. The time-restricted eating group did stick mostly to eating between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m., and the control group that was restricting calories but could eat at any time, they chose to eat between 8 a.m. and 7 p.m. So what was the result? Both groups saw a reduction of their hepatic triglycerides, their liver fat. Most of the drop happened in the first 6 months, and then it kind of plateaued for the rest of the year, the rest of the trial. And there was no significant difference between the two groups. Both people cutting calories and people cutting calories plus doing time-restricted eating seemed to benefit about similarly. Now, this is the average of all the participants in the trial, and it's very interesting that when you look at the participants one by one, this is called the waterfall plot, and there's a huge variation. Each bar is one person, gray is the control group restricting calories, and yellow is the calorie restriction plus fasting group. So you can see some people lost a lot of liver fat, some saw little difference, and a few even got worse. Their liver fat increased. This variation is possibly explained by compliance. Some people just find it easier to stick with the program than others, and we'll come back to this in a minute. They also measured a large number of other metabolic parameters: body fat percentage, subcutaneous fat, visceral fat, BMI, blood pressure, cholesterol levels, fasting glucose, hemoglobin A1C, just a lot of stuff. And the pattern was the same. All of those parameters got better, improved in both groups, and there was no statistically significant difference between the two groups. There was only one parameter out of the 20 or so that they looked at where they suggest there might have been a significant difference between the groups: insulin resistance, measured using a model called HOMA-IR. During the first 6 months, both groups saw an improvement in their insulin resistance, a drop in insulin resistance, but during the second 6 months, the second part of the trial, the group doing the time-restricted eating, the fasting, they kept improving a little bit more, whereas the control group that was just restricting calories didn't significantly improve anymore. They kind of plateaued. Now, it's hard to know if this is the real deal. The p-value didn't reach statistical significance, but there is some precedent in the literature for early time-restricted eating, this modality of eating all your calories earlier in the day to improve insulin resistance even when calories are matched. So there are some trials that indicate that. So I think it's theoretically possible. But the vast majority of the parameters they looked at were not significantly different between the two groups. So why would that be? When they looked at estimated caloric intake, Both groups were in a caloric deficit. They were hypocaloric, as planned. About 600 to 700 calories a day under expenditure in a hypocaloric state. There was no significant difference between the two groups in the amount of calories eaten. So it sounds like they ate about similar amounts of food overall, but the fasting group ate that same amount in a tighter time window earlier in the day. And physical activity also wasn't significantly different between the two groups, which they were asked not to change the level of physical activity during the trial so that the investigators could focus on the effect of the dietary interventions. So caloric balance, overall caloric intake, would seem to explain the majority of the benefits experienced by both groups, with the possible exception of a difference in insulin resistance. And in fact, this is overall what the authors concluded, that calories seem to be the big player at stake. They also looked at the participants separated by compliance. Those that stuck better with the instructions, that were more compliant, saw a drop in liver triglycerides in both groups, with or without fasting, with no significant difference between the two, while the participants with the worst compliance saw no significant improvement in either group. So the main takeaway from this trial was that, at least the way they designed it, caloric deficit seemed to be the main lever. People benefited in proportion to how well they were able to stick with the treatments. In fact, the biggest differences seen in this trial were not between the treatments, the two groups. They were between individuals. Remember the waterfall plot? Obviously, we want to be here, not here. So the key is finding a strategy that we can individually stick with, whether that's focusing on cutting calories or fasting in the evening or something else. For example, fasting in the evening could be a great option for somebody for whom fasting helps them keep their calorie intake reasonable and maybe snack less at night. Whereas for somebody else who gets like ravenously hungry during the fast and then goes on a binge during the eating window, fasting might not be productive. It might even be counterproductive. So does eating earlier in the day, early time restricted eating, does that provide any extra benefit on top of calories? I think it's possible. The evidence is mixed right now. I don't think this is a settled issue. There are some trials that indicate an added metabolic benefit, but even if it is real, it does seem to be a pretty minor effect compared to the effect of calories. In fact, the design of this trial might not even be optimal because cutting calories, which remember both groups did, might drown out a smaller calorie independent effect, might make it harder to detect. I'm just hypothesizing. Another possibility is that the difference in eating window duration in this trial wasn't that big. One group was eating in an 8-hour window between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m., and the other group was eating in an 11-hour window. So maybe you need a bigger difference in time window to see an effect. Possible. So for people who like to eat all of their meals, all of their food earlier in the day, I don't see a problem with that. For those who can't fathom not having dinner with the family or friends or something like that, I don't think the evidence right now is strong enough to tell everybody they have to stop eating at 4 p.m. I'm completely open to it if the evidence in the future leans strongly in either direction. Right now, the evidence supports the two main factors being calories and, of course, food quality. A lot of people will say calories aren't the full picture, and of course, that's true. 100 calories of donuts is not the same thing as 100 calories of some whole food that's more health promoting. So that's primarily what I would focus on. I hope that helps. Let me know your questions below. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.